welcome everybody to this session of our community studies project. And today we're very fortunate to have with us Fred Goldstein from New York.
Okay, well, before I tell you what I think, I would just like to ask the audience, how many people here have their own definition of capitalism, think that they feel they know and confidently could explain what capitalism is? Okay. How many people have studied or are familiar with globalization as an idea? Okay. Well, that's important because I want us all to be on the same page. So maybe that says where I should start, because I wrote a book about low-wage capitalism, and a lot of it is centered around the globalization process and its effect on the standard of living of workers in this country and people in general in this country, as well as people in low-wage countries. And the term globalization is kind of a neutral term in the sense that it doesn't tell you much about where globalization comes from, what its class consequences are, and how it fits into a broader socio-economic system of capitalism. So I would just like to say a few words about globalization from my perspective and from what I believe to be a scientific perspective. Globalization is the process by which large corporations with tremendous resources use these resources and the technology available to them based upon a very recent scientific technological revolution, computerization, etc., to expand their sphere of exploitation of labor around the world. That's what the globalization process is, as far as the Marxists are concerned. It's spreading an institution of capitalism from high-wage countries, countries that were high-wage, like the United States, Britain, France, Italy, Belgium, out into countries that have been historically colonized and underdeveloped, like India, like China, like Indonesia, like Vietnam, like Mexico, like Guatemala, like El Salvador and Costa Rica. The productive forces, the factories, even office work is being sent abroad to places where workers are desperate for any kind of wages, many of them poor, rural poor, agricultural workers. And the corporations in the United States have understood this and have decided to move out and exploit these workers and take advantage of the fact that they're desperate for jobs and hire them at very low wages. That's really what the whole thing is about. And why do they want them at low wages? Because it means higher profits. Because that's what capitalism runs on. Profits. It's a profit system. Everything that's produced and created, for the most part, under a capitalist system of private ownership of the means of production, of the economy, of services, hospitals, malls, shopping malls, whatever it is, auto factories, all these things that are owned privately by very wealthy people, this is all used to make profit. We all wear clothes. We all have our shirts and dresses and pants and whatever on today. And all of this was created not because we need them, not because we like them and it's useful. It's because the owners that control the workers who produce these things made a profit. Without the profit, there wouldn't be a shirt and pants or a Boeing 747. That's what all production and economic activity under capitalism begins with. The motivation for somebody to get rich. And how do they get rich? They get rich from the labor of the workers who create the goods and services that are automatically belong to the owner, don't belong to the person who created the service. Whether you're a nurse, an orderly in a hospital, whether you're in a shopping mall and you're a salesperson, or you're an auto worker on the production line, or wherever. The way that the auto companies, the hospitals, the mall owners, Walmart's owners, the way they get rich is from our labor. Everything that moves in this society is moved by workers. Everything that's done is done by workers. Every wall that's painted, every nail that's hammered, every weld that's welded is done by workers. The owners don't do it, but what they own what we create and they sell it for a profit. If they can't sell it for a profit, then they stop producing. They lay off the workers, and you have what we have now, got 25 million people unemployed or underemployed. That's the profit system, and that's what capitalism is about, and that's what globalization flows out of. The search for higher profits. I want to just read something from the book. I'm not going to read a whole lot, but this is something that was written by a guy named Thomas Friedman. Thomas Friedman is a columnist for the New York Times. He's kind of a famous, he's a millionaire. And his wife is a millionaire independently of him. He's very wealthy. And he's really excited about globalization. It turned him on, like, tremendous. And he travels in wealthy circles. So he knew the owner of Dell Computers. You all have Dell Computers? The guy's name is Dell. He founded the company. But Friedman, he got so intoxicated with globalization that he talked to Michael Dell, who owns the company, and he was about to write a book called The World is Flat. And so he asked Michael Dell, he said, can you tell me, I just bought a computer to work on my book. Can you tell me how my computer that I just bought was produced, because it's a Dell computer? So I don't know if Dell himself explained this to Friedman, but this is what he got. This is the information that he got from the Dell company about his computer. He says, once his order was placed, it went to Penang, Malaysia, one of the 6 Dell factories in the world. The other factories were in Limerick, Ireland, Jiangmen, China, El Dorado in Brazil, Nashville, Tennessee, and Austin, Texas. Surrounding every Dell factory in all of these places are numerous parts supply centers called supply logistics centers, owned by different suppliers. They're like staging areas. If you're a Dell supplier anywhere in the world, your job is to keep the supply logistics center full of specific parts so they can constantly be trucked over to the Dell factory for just-in-time manufacturing. Dell Malaysia sends an email every 2 hours to this suppliers telling them what they want within the next 90 minutes. So this could be in Ireland, it could be in Malaysia, it could be in Indonesia, it could be in China. But this is what happened. The Intel, now he's talking about his computer. The Intel processor came from an Intel factory located either in the Philippines, Costa Rica, Malaysia, or China. The memory came from a locally owned factory in South Korea, Taiwan, Germany, or Japan. The graphics card could have come from a Taiwanese owned factory in China, the motherboard from a Korean factory in Shanghai, the hard disk from a Japanese factory in Indonesia. I won't go on. But you get the point. These countries that I just named, Indonesia, Malaysia, they're all countries that have been historically kept underdeveloped by colonialism. And they have very low standards of living. And for somebody to make $2 a day in Indonesia is a step up from rural poverty. Or in Mexico, it's the same thing. The Mexican border is lined with what they call maquiladoras, factories, special places where there's no taxes. For the corporations pay no taxes. They contract out to these Mexican workers in these factories all along the Mexican border. They get paid $1 an hour, maybe $2 an hour. They create motherboards of computers, they create textiles, they create jeans, they create shirts. They come back over the border and are sold by Dell, or they're sold by Hewlett Packard, or they're sold by the fashion industry, and so on. And these workers are kept in a low wage condition. But here's the rub. It affects every worker in the United States. Globalization is like an invisible force. Because when you get out of school and you go for a job, let's say you go for a job in a law firm, okay? And part of your job is to draw up legal briefs because you're just starting and they want you to know how to create a legal document and what it's like. You're competing with people in India and in the Philippines and in Ireland because these are all English-speaking countries. And because of computers and communications technology, they can create the same document that you can at a tenth of the price, at a tenth of the wage. So when you get out of school, if you go to a law firm and try to get a job as a law clerk or something, you're not just competing with all your other students who want to get a similar job, you're creating globally with a global workforce that has been created by the capitalists who use the technology to have us competing one against the other, not just in one city, not just in one state, and not just in one country, but all over the globe. And it's a race to the bottom. That's what it's called, the race to the bottom of wages, to get the lowest possible wages for the capitalists so that they can get the most profit. That's what globalization is. Whatever fancy things they want to say, that it creates efficiency, it creates integration, all of those things are true. But that's not the essence of it from a social, economic, class point of view. The essence of it is that it's expanded exploitation that's driving down wages all over the world and in the high-wage countries like the United States, rapidly bringing wages down everywhere. So that's how we view, you have to view globalization as an outgrowth of the capitalist profit system. I just here's an anecdote, just to show you how globalization goes both ways. This morning, I opened up the computer and I saw an article, I forget where it was printed. It's about IKEA. Does anybody here know about IKEA? You ever buy IKEA furniture? IKEA is a Swedish company. In Sweden, the unions are strong. The average wage in an IKEA factory is $19 an hour. Plus, they get 5 weeks vacation, which is a government thing, mandated. Plus, they get a national health plan. So IKEA, who sells in the United States, decided, well, $19 an hour, maybe we have a better way. So they opened up a factory in Danville, Virginia, where they pay $8 an hour. So IKEA, so Sweden and IKEA are globalizing into the United States because wages have been driven down so far in the United States that they're lower than they are in Sweden and in many places in Europe. So if you think about it, they're looking at the south of the United States and probably the Midwest by now as like a third world country, the way the capitalists here look at China or Indonesia and so on. So this is the effect of globalization in the United States has been to bring wages down. Let me give you an example of how this works, specifically. How it works with the industrial union. I believe it was the machinist union who had organized a company called Stanley Tools. Now, I don't know if anybody ever saw Stanley Tools. If you go in any construction site, you'll see rulers, you'll see chisels and hammers made by Stanley Tools. It's a global company, and it's been around for a long time. And its headquarters is in Bridgeport, Connecticut. Stanley Tools, once this new software and communications technology began to be developed, moved a lot of its operations to Thailand. Now, let me just preface this by saying, part of the globalization and the technological development of capitalism is that there are these new software programs where a capitalist boss can sit and his executives can sit in a room. And the four walls are lined with computer screens. And on one wall, they'll have maybe a dozen factories around the world, and they can look at what's going on in that factory. It's called the cockpit. It's made by a German company called SAS, the computer program. On another wall, they'll have their financial statements that are geared to the production that's going on in the company real time. And there are other walls, they have other information, but it's not important for them. Now the people in Stanley Tools in Bridgeport, Connecticut, the bosses, they have this software and they could see what's going on in their factories in Thailand and wherever they are. And in the factory floor in Bridgeport, where the workers are still making tools under union contract, they have a big board. And every hour or 2 hours, they put up on the board the production that's going on in Thailand. And if they threaten the workers that if they don't keep up with the production that's going on in Thailand, they'll move the whole thing to Thailand. And so it makes the workers work faster, work harder, and it makes the union more frightened and timid and afraid to bargain for conditions and wages and benefits, pensions, health care. It intimidates the workers, and it intimidates the union. So they don't even have to move the factory to Tyria. They can drive wages down just by pitting the workers in Thailand against the workers in Bridgeport. That's a specific example. There are other examples in the book, that's not in the book, that you can read in the book. I'll give you an example of it right here at home, of how technology is used. It's not a matter of globalization. Although there are, so I'll give you this one, McDonald's. McDonald's experimented with a communication system where in the drive-thrus, where in order to eliminate errors in communication between the drive-thru person who takes the drive-thru order and the kitchen who creates the order, they would beam the order electronically, and it would go through a third country and come right back to the kitchen. And in order to eliminate any errors. Now, I don't know if they implemented this throughout the system. They may have found a way to do it much more easily. But this is the way technology is used. Technology, which we think of as something that advances production, advances and creates nice things like iPhones, and creates Twitter, and creates high-speed computers and the internet and all of that. It's created in order to intensify the exploitation of workers. I was just in a Dunkin' Donuts. I don't know if you have them here. You have Dunkin' Donuts here? Next time you go in a Dunkin' Donuts drive-thru, look up above the takeout, the drive-thru part. You might see two little screens, okay? One screen counts down, probably from 2 minutes and 30 seconds, and the other screen has a number on it, maybe between 80 and 90. What are these two numbers? Management tells the McDonald's manager in the store, the central management, gives them a time by which every single drive-thru order has to be completed from start to finish. The one I was in was 2 minutes and 30 seconds. The other screen is the percentage of successful completions of 2 minutes and 30 seconds getting the drive-thru. If you go below 85% in the particular one I was in, people get penalized. The manager gets written up, the workers get written up, and eventually people can get fired. This is the use of technology. You don't even need a foreman. You don't need a boss in the store. The workers are enslaved to that little clock. They got to keep their eye on that clock. And they got to move as fast as they can to get that thing done. That's how technology is used. So that Dunkin' Donuts can sell more, faster, and make more profit, and make the workers work faster, and get more customers through. That's how technology is used under capital. There's a big chain of grocery stores in the Midwest. I forgot the name of it. You can look it up. They experimented with software that times from the first time a customer comes to the cashier. The cashier has to push a button that it starts. And they have to get that customer through within a certain time, and they've set the time at so much and so much. And if they don't get that customer through they're in trouble. And enough misses and they get fired. Now, if somebody, you want to talk to somebody, you want to be like a human being, you actually want to converse with somebody who you see every day across the counter, you know, so-and-so who buys their groceries every day. No, you can't talk. If some older person is fumbling through their purse, trying to find some extra money, you know, they can't find the change or they can't find whatever, but you start to get nervous. You want to push them. You know, you want to strangle them. That's technology under capitalism. There's no end to the example. Okay? And that's what the globalization process is, only a part of that. It's part of that. How many people here shop at Walmart? That's a lot of people. Yeah. Walmart is the example of capitalism, you know, par excellence. And low wages, low wage capitalism. Walmart wrote the book on this before I did. Walmart has about somewhere between 4,000 and 5,000 stores in the United States. When I wrote this book in 2008, they had 4,000 stores. They're probably closer to 5,000 by now. They're the biggest retailer in Canada, the biggest retailer in Mexico. They're the second biggest retailer in England. They have contracts out all over the world, manufacturing contracts. So if anybody, even a big corporation, wants to have their stuff in Walmart, it's a big deal. It's important. You really need to be in Walmart if you're a big retailer. You want to sell whatever it is, jeans, shovels, pickles, whatever it is, food. To get into Walmart, to get on their shelves, you've got to meet their price. Because they sell at low prices. That's the big box store with the low prices. So what happens? You go to Benton, Arkansas, you're selling your sales representative, because that's where Walmart's headquarters is. It's a huge place. And there's thousands of people always waiting to get in to see them. And you come in to see them, and you say, this is what I've got. And they say, and then you tell them the price. If they like the price, they'll put it on the shelf. If they don't like the price, they tell you, come back with a lower price. How do you come back with a lower price? You start looking at low-wage countries. That's how you come back with a lower price. If you're manufacturing in the United States, you start to look at Vietnam or China or Indonesia so that you can come back with a lower price. There's a thing called the China price in Walmart. So just by virtue of the fact that this giant multi-billionaire corporation controls all of this retail, and uses and has everything, every shelf, every item in there is for profit, they promote globalization because they force their contract, their suppliers, to go and find the lowest wages wherever they can find them. So they go and they find subcontractors who have subcontractors, and they wind up come back to get on Walmart's shelf with a lower price. Plus, Walmart makes profit by keeping their workers' wages low. Most of Walmart's workers qualify for food stamps, Medicaid, and other forms of public assistance, even though they're working, because that's how low the wages are. And Walmart plays an even more pervasive role in society in terms of lower wages And it has to do with Marxism and Marxist analysis of what wages are and how exploitation works. According to the Marxist view of wages, and frankly, you don't have to even read Marx if you start thinking about it for 5 minutes. Wages are what it is necessary to keep workers alive. That's pretty much what it is. It's the subsistence, it's to keep workers at a subsistence level so that they can come back next day in some reasonable health and continue to be exploited and to continue to work for the boss. You don't pay the workers enough. You got to pay them enough to reproduce, to have a family, to create other workers, new generations of workers. It sounds crude and mechanical, but it's really true. You think about yourself. Think about your family. Think about your friends, everybody you know. They've been working. Their ancestors worked. Their ancestors' ancestors worked. Did they get wealthy from that? Did anybody accumulate, anybody know anybody who accumulated wealth as a worker? It doesn't work that way. You work day after day, you sell your labor to some boss every day, and what they give you back is what it takes to keep you alive. Maybe a little extra. You know, you can maybe, if you get a little more, you can go on vacation, a nice vacation. Maybe you could buy a flat screen TV and, you know, chill out and get whatever and get a car maybe, you know. But you live within a very narrow framework, all of us as workers, in a very narrow framework. So that's what wages are for, to keep you going. That's it. No more. And they want to keep that as low as they can. Because how do they get rich? They get rich by selling what you create, whether it's a service or a product. How does a hospital get rich? And they get rich. They don't show it necessarily on their own books, but they farm it out to the pharmaceutical companies, the medical instrument companies, the construction companies. The money goes to some capitalist that comes into a hospital. When you pay $600 a day for a bed, don't worry, somebody gets that. How do they get rich? Because of the nurses, because of the nurses' aides, the nurses, the physician's assistants, the clerical staff, who make the hospital run, who fix the patients, who care for the patients, who administer the drugs, who do make the beds. That's what is real. That's real. That's what is, but they sell that. You don't get paid because you do all this wonderful work. According to what you create, you get paid according to what they can get away with to hope that you can stay alive and that you'll accept. That's what wages are. That's what wages are. And the lower the wages, the more the profit the capitalist class as a whole makes. Now, come back to Walmart. That's where this all started. Walmart is the store that has cheap prices. Now, if you're General Motors in Flint, Michigan, and you want to drive down the wages of your workers, which they are doing, they went from $28 an hour to $14 an hour. Well, the fact that Walmart exists helps you, General Motors, or General Electric, or any big company, because you can pay lower wages, because Walmart exists. And you can squeeze your workers, and they can still stay alive by going to Walmart. So the entire capitalist class benefits from those 4,000 stores that Walmart has. Not just Walmart. Everybody and all the workers suffer because it allows the bosses to push your wages down. That's what wages are. Profit is unpaid labor. Profit, I always repeat that, it's unpaid labor. You get paid enough to keep you alive, but everything you create belongs to the owner, and they sell that. And if you produce $1,000 worth of shoes in a day in a factory, let's just say, or $1,000 worth of services in a hospital, let's just say, what do you get paid? $1,000 a day? $500 a day? Maybe you get $100 a day. Maybe $150 if you look. $200. The rest is your labor that the boss doesn't pay for. They give you your $200, but you worked all day to create $1,000 worth of stuff. So they get the $800 of your labor that they didn't pay for. That's what capitalism is. That's what exploitation is. Exploitation is stealing the workers' labor, getting unpaid labor from workers who create everything in society. That's capitalism. Anybody want to argue with me?
If the worker creates $1,000 worth of product, goods, or whatever, but they're not necessarily the ones that actually pay for the material, pay for the machine, pay for, you know, whatever, if they're using to make that.
That's true. So what's your point?
So I'm saying, you know, theoretically, the owner who is responsible for all that, you know, he's not necessarily taking all the profit, but he's either going to be bringing that to the company or doing the maintenance. So, you know, in some respect,
well, the owner didn't create the machinery either. The owner didn't create the... Let's take, okay, a shoe factory, leather, whatever, thread, needles, sewing machines, and so on. The owner didn't create that. He bought that. He didn't do anything. Workers created those. When they were being exploited in the needle factory, or in the sewing machine factory, or in the tanning place where they tanned the leather, those workers created all of that. The boss didn't create that. He just had enough money to buy it. What's the credit for that? And also, can I say this? Who needs him? Who the hell needs him? Why can't we as workers order that stuff to ourselves and use it? What do we need him for? What do we need the owner for? Are we not smart enough to figure out we need a machine to make shoes? And we need a needle? After all of this was created by us in the first place. It's a completely artificial idea that an owner is needed to organize production. Not at all. In fact, the real owners, the banks, the big stockholders, the bondholders, they're the real owners. When push comes to shove of General Motors or Walmart or any place, the real owners are multi-billionaires. They never come anywhere near a needle or a thread or a weld, or they never lift a paintbrush. They never change a bedpan. They never do anything. All they do is own it. And they pay people to organize production. They pay foremen, they pay executives to organize production. The owners. We can organize production. Here you're in school. You can learn how to organize stuff. And anyway, you know, you go in a hospital and a factory, the workers are the ones who know everything in the first place. You know. But I grant your point. That's true. What you're saying is that the bosses do pay for this stuff. But they pay for it from the labor that we created in the first place. That's where they got the money to pay. Like if you create $1,000 worth of goods, so I oversimplified it. You hit the nail on the head, because what you're saying was really filling in a gap that I left. If you get paid $200 for creating $1,000 worth of goods, the boss takes the $800, right? He doesn't keep all that $800. He's got to replace machinery. He's got to replace raw material. That's true. That's absolutely true. So he may not get the whole $800, because part of what you've created has to be used to reinvest in the company. But his profit comes from the extra. That's how. If he can't get that extra, after he pays you wages and he pays for the replacement of the machinery and the raw materials, if he can't get that extra, he shuts his business down and you're out of work. That's the name of the game. And that's what's going on all over the country now. That's why there is probably 30 million people who are either officially unemployed, have dropped out of the workforce, or are being forced to work part-time when they actually need a full-time job. Because the capitalists have created a society in which everything is so productive. There's so much technological productivity. So much can be produced by fewer and fewer workers can produce faster and faster, more and more goods. That's the nature of capitalism. They constantly do this. They try to get you to work faster, more efficiently, create more, and they put in technology to make it work and make it happen. But they keep everybody's wages down. Who's going to buy it? The faster they create it, faster and faster, they lower everybody's wages more and more. There's a crisis of what they call it, Marxists call a crisis of overproduction. The last crisis was so bad, this last economic crisis, that the big bosses had to put, the government, had to put several $1 trillion from the government into the economy to keep it from collapsing. And it was on the verge of collapse. When the collapse came, I don't know, do you remember 2008, 2009, the so-called financial crisis when everything collapsed? When all the smoke cleared and all the financial manipulations were all out in the open, what they didn't emphasize was this. There were 8 million houses on the market because of the housing boom, but only 6 million customers. They had an overhang of almost 2 million houses that couldn't be sold because they were all in a rush to sell and to build houses in the housing boom. Like every capitalist developer and every mortgage broker and every banker behind the mortgage brokers were pushing more, sell, more profit. But in the meantime, people were busted out on credit. And finally, the whole thing collapsed. So what happened? They stopped building houses. Construction workers lost their jobs. People who made rugs and carpeting, who made wallpaper, lumber, electrical equipment, appliances, these companies couldn't sell to the construction industry, to the developers. And it rippled back into the whole economy because nobody could sell at a profit. So layoffs began, and then there was huge, that 7.5 to 8 million workers lost their jobs in 2 years. In 2 years. From August 2007, actually less than 2 years, to the end of 2009, because of the profit system, because they couldn't sell for a profit. That's completely irrational. And I don't want to leave out the auto industry. Remember the bankruptcy proceedings of the GM and all of this in 2009 when Obama went down there and took his lawyers and everybody, and they sat with them and they said, you got to cut. You know, they were all losing money. They were losing billions of dollars a year, GM, Ford, and Chrysler. So Obama went in to save the industry. How did they save that industry? They laid off about 200,000 workers. They shut down plants. Before this last economic crisis, the auto industry was producing 17 million cars a year. Now they're producing about between 10 and 11 million cars per year. They had to shrink the auto industry, throw hundreds of thousands of workers out of work, shut down factories all over the place, and lower wages from $28 an hour starting pay to $14 an hour. That's how they saved the auto industry, by sacrificing hundreds of thousands of workers and lowering the wages of all future workers who come into the industry. That's called capitalist overproduction. That was what was behind this present crisis, the last crisis. So the more efficient they get, the harder it is for the economic system to move forward, because they produce more and more, faster and faster. Workers get less and less. The market doesn't grow anywhere near as fast as production. That's a law of capitalist development. Production develops at a breakneck speed under capitalism. Consumption crawls, because consumption is us. It's our wages. I mean, you know, the rich can only buy so many yachts and so many Lear jets and so many mansions and so forth. It doesn't keep the whole capitalist economy going. What keeps it going is millions and millions of workers who have to live every day and buy stuff. But if production goes faster and faster and things can only be sold for a profit, well, then the whole thing is bound to collapse.
Like, what do you come up with a solution to?
Thank you. Thank you. You read my mind, actually. Well, it seems complicated, but it's really quite simple. They spend reams and reams of paper, and volumes of books, and hours of TV to make things seem complicated. But it's really simple from a Marxist perspective. All of this should be owned by the people. It should not be owned by private individuals, and it should not be used for profit. It should be used for social use, human need, and the development of humanity. You take the profit motive out of it, you take all of these factories, all of these services, all of this great agricultural production, which could feed everybody. There's granaries in the Midwest, and silos, and storehouses filled with cheese, with milk, powdered milk, with agricultural products that are just sitting there because they won't put them on the market, because it'll bring the prices down and drop the profits for agribusiness. Open it up. They're building luxury condominiums all over the country. And they're throwing people out of their houses all over the country. Why should that be? It's all about private ownership. Housing should be a right for everybody. Every human being should have a decent house. They should have a job if they can, unless for some reason they have to stay home. They should have health care. This is supposed to be the finest health care system in the world. Yeah, try and get it. If you can afford a heart transplant, you're in good shape. But if you've got something wrong and you need dialysis and you don't have the right, and you don't have enough money, and you don't have the right health care plan, you die. I'm not exaggerating. So why shouldn't this health care system just stop being privately owned? Why do we need private health insurance companies? Society should own the health care system collectively. And it should be accessible and available to everybody on an affordable basis, if not free. You know little Cuba? 10 million people, a poor, undeveloped country, colonized by Spain for several hundred years, then colonized by the United States, finally threw them out in 1959, took the country back for themselves. They have free medical care. They have free education for everybody. And when there's a shortage, they ration everything so that all children get milk, all children get basic calories. That's a small country with no productive forces to speak of. Go ahead.
Okay. The medical care in Cuba, are you saying it's on par with the medical care here?
No. Some of it is better. Some of it is better. Their biomedical industry is an advanced biomedical industry. They've done all kinds of genetic studies. They can cure things. I don't have the statistics. The U.S. actually studies the Cuban biomedical industry. But I'm not saying it's on a par in the sense that they don't have the medical technology and the medical resources that the United States has.
But shouldn't quality be a concern there?
Sure. Stop the blockade. Let them develop as a country. Give them reparations for the 100 years that they stole all the sugar and the nickel and everything out of Cuba. Let the U.S. sugar companies give them reparations so that they can develop their country. Then their social system will be able to take advantage of medical technologies. But I was in Cuba with a friend who actually, I don't want to make this on a personal level, really, because anybody can have a good personal experience, you know, and it doesn't, you can't necessarily generalize it. But I believe this is characteristic of you. I call on you. This woman, she began to get headaches. She was there on a visit for, I forget what it was, some conference or something. And the headaches became more and more severe, and it turned out that she had some kind of serious brain problem in the front of her head. The Cubans just took her into the hospital, and she was there for free. For like 35 days, they wouldn't let her move. They tended to her care. Did you see the movie Sicko?
Yeah.
Remember the woman, the 9/11 victim?
Yes.
The Cubans took them in and gave them medical care. It's free. They take care of you. They care about human life in Cuba. And it's in spite of the fact that they don't have resources. They do not. In Cuba, if somebody sees a nail on the floor and it's bent, they straighten it out so they can use it again. Because of the blockade, because the U.S. has blockaded them for 50 years, and because of 200 or 300 more years of colonialism before that. I mean, Cuba used to be casinos. Did you see The Godfather, anybody? Godfather 2? Did anybody see Godfather 2? Remember them dividing up Cuba, the mobsters and the corporations? Without Al Pacino, that's true. That was true. Cuba was a place for the rich to go on vacation, for prostitution, gambling. It was a racist country too. It was so racist, black Cubans couldn't even go on the beaches in Cuba. Batista, who was the dictator of Cuba. The U.S. puppet dictator of Cuba, Butcher, the one who was finally overthrown by Fidel and Che and the revolution. He had black blood in him. He couldn't go on the beaches in Cuba. He couldn't belong to the clubs in Cuba. That's how racist the ruling class was in Cuba. He had to create his own beaches. He had to create his own club because he had black blood in him. That's what Cuba was like. People who were sick in Cuba, if they lived in a rural area, they would try to get on a boat or a raft and float and try to get to Havana to see if they could find a doctor to treat them. The first thing the Cuban Revolution did was to have the Year of Literacy and sent everybody out to teach people to read. The population was illiterate. Cuban sugar workers used to be unemployed 9 months out of the year because the harvest was 3 months. And they would harvest the sugar cane for the U.S. sugar companies for 3 months, and then for 9 months they would be unemployed in the countryside and couldn't live. But the Cuban Revolution took that all away from the owners. And as poor as they are, they managed to have free health care and free education for everybody in Cuba, as poor as they are, because of the social system of the abolition of private property. The abolition, not personal property. Personal property is your clothes, your toothbrush, you know, your house. That's your personal property. Private property means the property of the productive forces, the economy. Private, that's what private property means. When it's privately owned, they own the economy. In Cuba, the economy is collectively socially owned. They're having lots of economic difficulties. Don't let me make it out to be an economic paradigm. It isn't. It's very difficult. But in this country, with these factories, with this technology, you can have abundance and socialism at the same time. You'll have much more because production is held back by capitalism. Remember what I just said? The auto industry produced 17 million cars. Now they're producing 10 or 11. They're trying to get to 12. They hold back production because of profit.
If the capitalists and the mega corporations have a large stake in the government, who makes the laws that are pretty much against the workers, what is the final? What is the outcome? Where do we stand? Like in the applied socialism, do we revolt? What is the outcome?
Well. $64 question. I mean, you know, I belong to a party. It's called Workers' World Party. I belong to it since 1961. And I'm a Marxist, and I believe that the only way that we're going to get out of this is for the people to rebel, to organize. To organize, to fight back on a mass way, and to overcome them, to vanquish them, and change the system. I think everything else is an illusion. I've lived through big demonstrations. I've lived through ups and downs. And I've studied previous periods. And I say that the only way people can change their faith is by not waiting for anybody else to do it, but to get organized. There would still be segregation in the South, where black people died because they couldn't go to a white hospital, where a black person couldn't drink from a white water fountain, where the black schools were dilapidated, where children
in black schools used textbooks that were 7 or 8 years old that were hand-me-downs from the white school system, where people, a black person could be lynched for looking cross-eyed at a white woman. That would still be in force if it wasn't for the thousands and tens of thousands of people in the civil rights movement who put themselves on the line in mass demonstrations and faced the Ku Klux Klan, faced the sheriffs, faced the government, and said, we won't take it anymore. And they forced the capitalist government to change the laws. Come.
How would socialism fix a lot of these problems? Like, how would it replace the profit incentive and keep growth, well, keep stagnation away?
That's a great question.
And then keep everybody moving, that's but at the same question. Time, not too fast, like you were saying.
Yeah, that's a great question. Can we just hold it for 1 second?
Okay.
So basically, there wouldn't be unions in this country if the 1930s, right here in San Francisco, in the words, and in Los Angeles, in California, it started in San Francisco. In San Francisco in 1934, in the middle of the Depression, where workers, unions had been pushed way back and workers were at the mercy of the bosses because there was such mass unemployment. And there was a system on the docks in San Francisco, it was called the slave market. A lot of workers were black workers, but it wasn't only black workers, it was all a lot of them. The system of hiring for the docks and the big shippers and stuff to deal with the freight, it worked that the foreman from the company would go around to the bars in the neighborhood and say, you want to work? You work. You want to work? You work. You can work. Or they would go into the neighborhood and find people, and they would decide who worked, when, and how much. That was it. And the dock workers tried to organize against this, and they were having a great deal of difficulty. Now finally, they decided to call a strike. And they called a strike, and the strike grew. And then they found out that all the other maritime industries, the seamen, the various maritime workers, all had grievances too. And so they formed a big 50-person maritime committee for a strike. And they had a big mass demonstration, and the cops shot 2 workers, killed them. And then there was a big funeral. And from that funeral came a general strike in San Francisco, and they shut the city down. They were running, the workers were running San Francisco. You couldn't go to eat, nobody could open a restaurant, nobody could do anything without the strike committee telling them it's okay. It lasted for about 10 days. They didn't win everything they wanted, but at the end of the day, when the smoke cleared, they had the strongest union on the West Coast, and they still do. They still do. In fact, in Oakland, in Local 10, the same union that organized that general strike, the ILWU, just called, had a walkout, 1 day walkout, in solidarity with the workers in Wisconsin who are fighting to keep their union from being broken. It's the same union. My point is that they got it by organizing and fighting back resistance, and they did what was necessary. Whatever it took, they did. They used whatever force they had to use. They used whatever organization they had to use. And that's the only way we're ever going to get out of this mess. That's the truth. Everything else, voting is not going to get you out of it. Trust me. It's not going to get you out of it. Oh, exactly. It's not going to get you out of it. I want to come back to your question, which is the fundamental question. How are people going to be motivated? How are you going to be creative if there's no incentive? Is that,
the profit incentive?
The profit incentive. Yeah. Okay. All right. The question is, do people need to be driven by a desire for profit in order to be creative? Is that something that's in human nature? That's the fundamental question.
I think that you don't need that, but in a lot of the cases, if you don't have it, people can get lazy, especially on a large scale. Like, people become content with what they have and they won't want to move forward with it.
Okay, hold on. Did you want to jump into this conversation?
Yeah, to piggyback off of him as well. If you switch from profit to resources, what's stopping one group from taking resources and owning the resources the same way capitalists take the profit and own the profit and then own the means of production to make more profit?
You mean what's going to keep the capitalist system from being reproduced, growing out of?
Well, what I'm saying is the greed that comes with the profit system, if you switch to a resource system, meaning make something that we need, what's stopping someone from taking over that as well?
Okay. You see, this is a fundamental question. But let me go back to Cuba just for one second. Cuba's a poor country. If there would ever be an environment in which people would want to take advantage of the situation, it's in an environment where there's very scarce resources. Yet, the consciousness of the Cuban people, the social consciousness, is different from the social consciousness in the United States or in any capitalist country. A revolution changes people's consciousness. It transforms you. Struggle transforms you. Get into a struggle sometime. You'll see. You'll see how it does. But I don't want to reduce it to that. Here's the question. What is it that creates individual opportunism and individual greed in history? What is it? Is it something inherent? Because if it's inherent, then what you're getting at is that really that's what's going to happen no matter what form of social system you devise. Greed will insert itself into the system and start to break up solidarity, and people will try to become owners and corner something for themselves. Okay, let's come back to this. I want to give you an example and then get to the general point. If you go into the home of a millionaire, a rich person, and you were like, I had a TV camera, and you could watch the kitchen and see the refrigerator and all the food and everything in the kitchen. What you would observe would be that people would just come and go and take food for as they needed. And nobody would say anything. Nobody would care. The mother wouldn't say, oh, don't take that, we don't have enough, that's for tomorrow, don't take it. It's a totally relaxed atmosphere towards personal resources. If somebody's car breaks down and they go and buy a new car. My car's no good, I buy a new car. In the Rockefeller family, that would be like you going out and buying a stick of chewing gum. I'm serious. It's totally relaxed attitude. Why? Abundance, enough for everybody so nobody worries that what's being taken is being taken away from them because they feel secure. They feel, because a rich family, as far as personal things go, feel totally secure in their personal existence from day to day, that everything that they need is going to be available to them. Now, go take that camera and go into a poor person's house. There's maybe five kids, let's say. And you will see, you will be able to feel the tension around the kitchen. Or if something is broken, like an expensive lamp, tempers fly. One, scarcity. Scarcity, that's what. Abundance creates the basis for human solidarity, for the relaxation of tensions between human beings. Scarcity creates the struggle for survival, and it drives individual opportunism and greed. Now, I want to give you a personal example. This has not always been the case in human history. Indigenous populations, before the advent of private property, who lived as hunters and gatherers, who lived in tribal society, before things broke up into agriculture and state, they had a communal form of living based upon the fact that everybody had to cooperate or the group perished. Everybody had to cooperate. There was not some big social surplus that somebody could grab. You went on a hunt, maybe the person who threw the spear got the first cut of the animal, but it was distributed to everybody. Otherwise, humanity would have perished. It would have never gotten here if there wasn't a communal attitude towards society and resources. There was no class divisions in ancient tribal society, primitive, what's called primal society. I want to give you a specific example. My compañera, she's also my wife, she was going to teach English as a second language, and she was doing research in education. And she happened across a paper about a school in the Midwest that was a school where a lot of Native children went. They weren't allowed to be schooled on the reservation in those days. The Bureau of Indian Affairs made them go to the white schools. And there was an incident in a school where a teacher had the blackboard and put a problem on the blackboard and called five Native children up to the blackboard to solve the problem, and told them the first one to solve this problem, turn around. So they all did the thing, and nobody turned around. Because they were taught to help each other, not to compete against each other, not to fight with each other, and not to be above one another, because they had a communal culture in spite of the fact that they were living in this horrendous society. They lived on the reservation, but they went to school in the white school, and they took their communal values into the classroom, non-competitive. I mean, they would compete in sports and so on and so forth. But in the classroom, you get an advantage. You get to be over the other person, ahead of the other person, and nobody would turn around, and that was the reason. It's not human nature. It's social conditions that make people what you are. Human nature changes and evolves under different social circumstances. In the United States, if all of this wealth was used for the people, we could all laugh.
You mentioned earlier that the resources should be used for by the people, by working in development. But what I would like to know is, what about What about the exploitation of the environment and the mass extinction of species and entire ecosystems? How do we approach this impending crisis that can be unsustainable?
Well, I mean, I've always thought to myself, if there was ever an argument for getting rid of private property, that's it. I mean, I can't imagine a stronger argument for getting rid of this capitalism than what they're doing to the environment. Profit respects nothing. Not polar bears, not whales, not rainforests, not the glaciers, not the earth and the water in the ground. I don't see how this problem is going to be solved under capitalism. I really don't. There's a whole new phenomenon about called fracking. You hear fracking? They look for natural gas. They take these poisonous chemicals. They put them in water. And they send them underground to break up rock formations that contain natural gas so that they can get the gas out of the earth. Meanwhile, I've seen this on television. People can light their tap water on fire. You take a match, you can see people who in these areas light their tap water on fire. Because of the volatility of these poisonous chemicals that are sent into the water table by the gas and oil companies looking for natural gas because it's the big thing now, natural gas. It's supposed to be clean, you know, efficient, cheaper than oil. It's going on all over the country. It's happening in New York State. There's a struggle against fracking. This is just one tiny little segment of how the profit motive disregards everything. Look at Japan. Look at the nuclear disaster. Now, I'm not a nuclear expert, and I don't know why it happened. But I know this. They bought those nuclear installations from General Electric. And General Electric designed those nuclear installations. And when they did in 1971 or 72 design them, the Nuclear Regulatory Commission and all the nuclear experts said the design was inadequate. But the GE did it because it was cheaper. Among the various things they did, which is almost unbelievable to me, you know what nuclear spent fuel rods are? Every nuclear reactor, the core reactor, has nuclear rods in it, filled with uranium little pellets, put into these rods, and these rods heat up the water by the radiation. They heat the water, they create steam, the steam drives the turbines create electricity. So what happens, these fuel rods last about 6 or 7 years. Then they have to be taken out because they can't create enough heat to generate the turbines. So what do they do with them? They're still radioactive as hell, but they can't be used for creating heat. They put them in these pools to keep them cool, to keep them contained. And it's called nuclear spent fuel pools. And they keep piling up year after year, because you can't move them for 10 years. You can't even move them for 10 years. GE designed this nuclear installation, which Japan bought, because it was cheaper to put these nuclear pools where they put the spent nuclear rods on top of the reactor. So if anything happens in the reactor, it breaks open these nuclear pools that have all these spent fuel rods in it. And that's what the big problem is. And these fuel, where the nuclear reactor, where the nuclear spent rods are, have no special container. And GE designed this because it was cheaper, because they could make more profit. you can just take this into the Brazilian rainforest, the Indonesian rainforest, the timber companies cutting it down, clear-cutting forests, destroying the land so that flooding takes place because trees prevent flooding. There's no end to it.
There, I'm holding my hand for, I saw a hand here and a hand here.
Yeah, I just had a comment on the last three questions. I think more like the solution would be more people have to live in necessity, like not live out of the means that they need. So that would create more of like what you were saying, they want to create more of like overinflation.
Okay, see, let me get this straight. You're saying that people shouldn't be acquiring so much stuff.
You just get what you need. Like, not everybody needs three cars. Not everybody needs five rooms in a house. You know, stuff like that. I think if people live like what they actually need, they won't have the problems.
And they won't feel that they need five cars if they don't have to think about it. They don't have to worry. What do you have to think about? How do I get from here to there? That's your concern.
Yeah, pretty much.
And when society, when people become more socially connected to each other, and individualism begins to fade, because people get in the habit, social cooperation becomes a way of life. You know, people naturally want to cooperate. They really do. When there's a natural disaster, you'll see people not asking for a nickel or a dime. They'll come from all over to put sandbags on a river to help each other out. When I was in New York City one time, there was a complete failure of the electricity. Everybody just spontaneously helped each other out. When it's over, they go back to the life of a rat race, and all of that good feeling goes away. But if society is structured that way, it never goes away. It just gets stronger. And then nobody needs five cars or anything like this.
I mean, everybody's programmed to want all this stuff. That's kind of how it is.
Yeah, well, have there been instances or incidents that you've heard of that people have tried to rebel and change the system?
Yes, there have been. Well, the first big one was the Russian Revolution in 1917. It's called the Bolshevik Revolution because that was the name of the party that led that revolution. And it was a revolution that overthrew the Tsar. It took place during the war. It's very important. World War I, a bloody war where millions of people were being killed. And it was a very oppressive society. It had been run by a czar, but it had capitalism was developing in the country, and the workers were organized into a lot of the workers were fighting in the military, and the Bolshevik Party told them to stop fighting the other workers in Germany and let's take over here. And the peasants had been living under the big landlords, and the Bolshevik Party encouraged the peasants to get rid of the landlords. And the workers and the peasants united, and they overthrew the capitalist class. They took over, they nationalized everything. But the problem with that revolution is that it took place in a very, very poor country, where 85% of the people were illiterate. And it was a very difficult revolution.
How about here in the United States, have you heard?
There's never been an attempted revolution in the United States. There was some revolutionary uprising. There was in the United States. They were close to it, but they were crushed.
What you're thinking about, what's happening in Wisconsin with the Wisconsin Revolution?
I think the Wisconsin Rebellion, the people know what happened in Wisconsin. Yeah. Does the governor Walker's name mean anything to people? Okay, so just to recap it. Governor Walker, Republican governor, decided to break the public employees' unions in Wisconsin by not allowing them to bargain collectively for pensions, for health care, or for any benefits, only allowing them to bargain collectively for wages, and only for wage increases equal to the increase in inflation, and to not allow them to collect union dues, which destroys a union, and to force them to recertify themselves as a union every year. And not only that, but to get 50% plus one of the total workforce, not just of the people who vote. So basically, he passed a law to destroy the unions, which affects about 200,000 workers in the state of Wisconsin. When this law was being put forward in the legislature, the unions began to demonstrate in Wisconsin. And a new thing happened that hasn't happened in a long time. There's a thing called the Taft-Hartley Law in the United States. And every state has the equivalent of it, where teachers and public workers are not allowed to go on strike. Within a few days of this struggle in Wisconsin, all the teachers who have been under the most vile attack, and I could talk about that for an hour, they sicked out. They didn't ask the union leadership, they didn't ask the school board, they didn't ask anybody. They said, we're all calling in sick, and they all sicked out. And the students followed them. And the students with the workers took over the state capitol, all four floors, inside, and tried to stop the legislature from passing the bill. And the teachers stayed out for 3 days. That was a new thing. And workers came from all over the state, building trade workers, iron workers, construction workers, firefighters. There was even a big tractor, because Wisconsin is an agricultural state. There was a tractor brigade that came from the rural areas. Several miles of tractors came to Madison to support the workers in Wisconsin. This is a new development pertaining to your question. It's not a revolution. But compared to what's been going on in the United States since the Reagan administration and before, this is a new thing. It's a new breath of fresh air. It's a new show of solidarity. In Los Angeles, you all had a demonstration of 15,000 people last Saturday in solidarity with Wisconsin. This is a new development. The organizers of that demonstration invited the head of the firefighters union, who's black, the first black firefighters, president of the firefighters union in the history of Wisconsin. He was a militant in the Wisconsin struggle. They invited him. He spoke here. He was on the platform. And he was an honored guest. That's a new development. Los Angeles, the SEIU Public Workers Union and the Communication Workers Union asked for volunteers to go to Wisconsin. And they got so many that they couldn't handle it all. But they did charter a plane load to fly to Wisconsin to show solidarity with the workers of Wisconsin. That's something new.
Could you comment on what appears to be a growing strength of the conservative movement in America? Because it doesn't quite align with the other new thing that you just described.
That's you're absolutely right. There's two trends in U.S. society right now. One is on top, and one is on bottom. the top, the rich, the bankers, and everybody, the Koch brothers, who, does that, do people know who the Koch brothers are? They're billionaires. They have industries all over, but they're based in oil. Biggest private corporation in the United States. They financed a lot of this kind of stuff. They've been moving to the right. Frankly, I want to say this, ever since the Soviet Union collapsed, the ruling class in this country has been moving to the right. And they've been getting further and further and further to the right. Because they've been beating down the unions, they've been beating down the people, and they beat down the resistance. And when there's no resistance, they will just keep taking and taking and taking and taking until the people get in the way. That's the way capitalism works. The capitalists take what they can get. They want to destroy the public education system in this country. They are coming. The bankers have discovered, and the hedge funds and the rich have discovered one of the great, that they're running out of places to get money. So they're always thinking, where can we get money? And they discovered, hey, every city in this country, especially the big cities, they all have these big education budgets. Let's go after that. That's hundreds of billions of dollars. So all of a sudden, I'll catch you. I got you. You start to see on television, teachers are lazy. They're bureaucrats. The unions won't be enforcing everybody to have bad teachers in the schools. Charter schools is the way to go. Obama has the race to the top, where they put out $4 billion pot to tell every school system, district in the country, go start privatizing your schools, go into charter schools, start putting in standardized testing, start putting in performance and so on to break the teachers' union. Because why? First of all, they don't give a damn about education of the mass of the people. If they did, they wouldn't defund the public education system. They wouldn't take the resources from it. They would support the people who need education by getting them out of poverty so they could go to school not hungry and not homeless and not worrying about everything under the sun, and they could pay attention to their studies. They would reduce the class sizes. They would bring all of these computer walls that they got, you know, where you got a whole wall that's a computer blackboard, and you can teach everybody. They would put it all. They would take 0.1% of the military budget and put one of those in every classroom in the country. Well, but they don't want. You know what? They don't want it. That's right. You've got workers. They want cheap workers. And because they've simplified the process of production, you don't need the skills, so to hell with you. We won't educate you. We'll educate a few, the elite. People who can make it through the charter schools, people who can get up into the Ivy League or into the, you know, the fancy schools. We'll educate them.
Obama.
Yeah, right. But education used to be needed by the bosses because you needed to know how to count and do division and do things. If you're in a machine shop, if you were a carpenter, if you were a seamstress or whatever you were, you needed a skill. Now that they've automated everything, you don't need to know how to weld. You don't need to know how to paint. You don't need to know how to do machine work. Why should we educate these people? We want a proletariat that we need. No skills, low wages. That's what we need. To hell with the public education system. So it serves two purposes. They create the working class that they need, and don't create one that they don't need. And it also opens up all these budgets to all the hedge funds who want to finance all these charter schools all over the country and get their hands on the education. But you had your hand up in the back. Somebody else.
There were a couple of hands
down there. Oh, it was you, I'm sorry.
So say that we do switch to socialist. How would our economy survive? And if there are other countries that are capitalist, won't they fully get the working?
I'm sorry, won't they what?
If we are all socialists, then would our economy survive? And how would other countries, will we be at the mercy if they're capitalist?
Well, you know, that's a good question, but they wouldn't like it. They would, I mean, we may have to fight a few wars. But I'm just kidding. But the U.S. is the center of the world economy. It's the biggest market. If they want to sell their goods, they got to sell to the United States. But also, a revolution here, it'll spread. Let me tell you, this is the monster that's keeping it all down. Mm-hmm. This monster is keeping the world down. Everybody's waiting for this monster to fall. Let me tell you, where are they? In Egypt, or in Guatemala, or in Colombia, or in Tanzania? They're all waiting to get the United States off their back, because it's all the multinational corporations who are globalizing and penetrating and keeping them down. The guy in back here is important.
If we were completely socialist, that would mean the government would probably control the media, right? Which would mean that everything would have to filter through the government in order to make it to the people. So wouldn't there be quite a bit of indoctrination? Propaganda from the government?
Well, okay, let's take that. How would you get to be, let's say the mass of the people, the working class, okay, we took over the government. We have organizations, by the way, you don't just take over. You don't just take over society. You have to create an organization to do it. It's a big social, it's a very complex thing. That's why I belong to a party, because you need an organization to help shape how you do all of this. And then not just one party, you need people's organization. In Cuba, there's a Cuban Federation of Women, there's a Cuban Trade Union, there's Cuban peasant organizations, there's national assemblies, there's local assemblies. It's a huge, complex social system, even in a small country of 10 million people. And so, when you're talking about a socialist society here, it doesn't pop out of thin air. It's the creation of prior organization of the people and raising of the consciousness of the people socially and in every way to get there in the first place. So you're not like taking a group of people who have been totally indoctrinated by capitalism and living in a capitalist mentality, suddenly becoming socialists, suddenly administering a socialist society. You have people who have in the process is everything in some way. The process of getting to socialism changes the people who bring it about. And so, therefore, the idea that the media, the people who are going to be in the media, are somehow not socially conscious and are narrow and opportunist and want to put some propaganda forward that's contrary to the interests of society, it doesn't fit. It doesn't work, because those people are the people who took over, and they were part of the process of taking over, and they in that process became socially conscious and have no reason, whatever, no motivation to try to go against the interests of society in general. The interests of those who administer society and the broader society as a whole coincide. There's no longer an antagonism the way there is under capitalism. the administrators of society, the FBI, the CIA, the Justice Department, the Agricultural Department, the Homeland Security Department, the Federal Communications Commission, the Federal Trade Commission, the Environmental Protection Agency. Their interests, they all come from lobbyists. They all come from big corporations. They all come from, they were corporate lawyers, they were whatever, business people. They come from the top. Their interests are antagonistic to the broad masses of people whom they administer over. So that antagonism disappears when we get rid of them and we become them. We become the administrators.
In your own opinion, what says the people from the U.S. from having a rebellion like the one happening in the Middle East?
What? Time. It's just a little bit of time. So, but it's going to happen. I think it's going to happen.
So do you think that this country needs to pretty much drop to the bottom in order to get us a rebellion to happen?
Absolutely. And I think the Egyptians started something that spread. Well, the Tunisians started in Tunisia. But Egypt is the center of the Middle East. It's the biggest country. It's the cultural center. And they waged a huge struggle to get rid of Mubarak, to get rid of this dictator who had been put in by the UN. They have a long way to go. The military is still over them. But that's a beginning. But I think nothing less than that has to happen in the United States. And will happen. And it won't happen because I say so, and it won't happen because it's a good idea. It'll happen because the capitalists are driving everybody towards it, in that direction.
Well, I have to add something to your part. People always complain about the government controlling the media and everything, but corporations control our media every single day, but nobody really seems to say anything about that. And the question that I wanted to ask you was, do you think that the government feels a revolution coming to the point where they want to get rid of education? Because education teaches us to become aware of our situations. So do you think that they're...
This is an excellent point. Because somebody talked to me, a teacher talked to me the other day, about the hidden side of charter schools. They can take control of the curriculum in the charter schools, and they teach reactionary indoctrination. You can't study black history, you can't study Latino history, you can't study women's history or lesbian gay history in a charter school. You can study the narrow standard that they demand that you teach to, and they don't want any rebellious, dissenting ideas in a charter school. And that's an ideological sign of the privatization of the educational system, which is very important. And when they're anticipating rebellion, and they want to see if they can't make sure that they diminish the possibility by taking control of people's minds. And you're absolutely right about what your first point was. Every form of communication of a mass character in this country is controlled by corporate. All of them.
Can you explain how the creation of false consciousness by the capitalist class has made American citizens so apathetic about the revolution? Because a lot of us don't think that we need a revolution because we're too much worried about what's going on or who we are or what status we hold, versus really truly understanding that the status that we do hold is not the one we think we hold.
You know something, what you just said is so important. And I think there's a saying in Marxism, being determines consciousness. What that means is this. If you're oppressed and exploited, sooner or later, that's going to come into your consciousness. The United States government, media, Hollywood, Newsweek, Time, U.S. News and World Report, ABC, NBC, CBS, CNN, Fox, all of them, 24 hours a day, try to create this false consciousness. Okay. But at a certain point, the false consciousness of people runs up against their mind, and they can't go on living in the same old way. And then that's the moment when consciousness can change. When you can't go on living in the same old way. In a way, that's what happened to the Wisconsin worker. All of a sudden, the ground just shifted from under them. They were ready to take a concession. They were ready to say, okay, we'll all sacrifice, which is ridiculous. The bankers don't sacrifice, the bosses don't. Nobody sacrifices, just us. But they were, had that false consciousness that you talked about. You know, okay, we'll get back on the pension, we'll give some of our health care. But then all of a sudden, bam, they're going to take our union away. We're going to be powerless. When you don't have a union, your renters is the first job you get. Or if you have a job, you already know it. You work at will. That's what it's called. You work at will. You work at the will of the employer. If you have a vacation, it's because the employer gives it to you. They can take it away from you. If you have overtime pay, it's because the employer gives it to you. Everything that you, every condition of labor without a union is at the will of the boss. And that's what the workers in Wisconsin suddenly faced overnight. By one stroke of the pen, by one government stroke of the pen, and it changed their consciousness. And they decided, the hell with this, we're going to rebel. And so I think this is a very important point. And I think that's what happened in Egypt. It would happen in Egypt. People were notoriously apathetic in Egypt until somebody killed some, the police killed somebody, and the strike was broken. And it got on YouTube, but it got around. And some young people decided to call a protest. And they did it on Facebook. And in a couple of days, they had 700,000 people, friends. And then they called for a demonstration. And the society had reached a point where they couldn't go on in the old way, with Mubarak and the dictatorship. And they just, the consciousness changed, and they all assembled in Freedom Liberation Square, Tahrir Square, and they wouldn't go away. And they fought. They fought. Mubarak brought out his thugs. Remember that? I don't know if you remember that. They came on horses with whips and machetes, and they had knives, and they had bottles, and they had pipes. And there were unarmed students and youth in the Tahrir Square, and for 3 days they fought them off and held that square. And that saved the struggle. That struggle of those students, they weren't students. Really. Some of them were Muslim Brotherhood people. There were all kinds of people. And that, because consciousness changed.
So it's going to take the younger group, just like with President Obama, where people are saying, well, why can't we have a black president? Well, why? You know, what's the deal? If he meets the standards, he meets the standards. You know, what if race doesn't come into picture? It's going to take this generation to be the one to have a result.
Hear, hear. I vote for that. This is the future. It's absolutely true. We're too conservative now. No, it's true. It's true. Those who have the youth have the future. The youth have the future. And it's true what you said. The college, they keep saying, the answer is education. The answer is education. Education. Okay, I'm for education. But let's have the right kind of education. The education that teaches us to overthrow them, to get rid of them. Because no other education is going to do us any damn good. We're going to go into low wages. We're going to go into unemployment. My daughter is a college graduate. She lives in Boston with three women. They're all college graduates. Two of them are nannies. One of them is a part-time teacher, a part-time arts teacher. And they can't find a job. They can't. They can't get a decent job.
What happened in Egypt, I think a lot of people thought that it was their own personal trouble. And realistically, when they all started talking about, like, I'm going through the same thing, they realized that it was a public issue. So do you think that with us it's going to take that? Because I can guarantee there's a lot of people struggling right now that are going to school and they're working full time. They're still not making ends meet.
Right.
So what do you think it would take for everybody to realize that we're all in the same situation?
Well,
because the media isn't going to televise that for sure.
Yeah.
I think you gotta get organized. You could start even right here. Everybody in this room, you could meet. Well, everybody who wants to, you could meet. And you could decide, we want to bring this up. Hey, it's not you, it's the system. You could have a piece of literature that says, hey, brother, sister, it's not you, it's the system. Let's talk. Get together, organize, build an organization, spread the word. Don't just keep going in this narrow channel of an individual, like you said. People, let everybody realize that it's not just me. And that the only way I'm going to get any place, we're going to have to hold together. That's the only way. I mean, I don't see any reason why this group right here, right now, some segment of you all couldn't get together and start something. Start something right now. You don't have to wait until tomorrow or next day or next month or next year. Start it now, because this is the only way it's going to happen. And then if you start it, you take it to the other campuses and you take it to the community and you begin to organize. And the next time they want to shove something down your throat, close your school in your neighborhood, do whatever. You get out in the streets. You get out in the streets and you say, no way. And you just, there's no way. The rest of it is all, it's an illusion. Everything else is an illusion. Struggle is the only way, and with organization and with a goal. You set your goals, you get organized, and you get into struggle. And you communicate. Communicate, communicate, communicate. Everybody here can write. Everybody here can put something down on paper. Do it. Do it.
Yes. Well, I'm disagreeing with a lot of what you have to say. I'm a conservative person myself. I do vote Republican. And a lot of the things you're saying, I can't see them realistically working. And without limiting our freedom to a very large degree. And also, I'm not really fluent with a lot of the social issues that you're talking about. But if we went back to the economic thing, you gave me a few examples, like specific examples, but you didn't really explain to me, or I didn't get it, how exactly socialist economics would prevent stagnation and still encourage the right amount of growth.
Well, we could talk about this. Socialism.
Well,
Excuse me?
It's
not profit sharing, it's surplus sharing, because it's not profit anymore.
How do you maintain the surplus with the
economy? The same way you made it.
Because you were talking about limiting production and having getting more people involved with the work, right? So you have to artificially control it.
You just start by socializing, by everybody owning it.
I'd like to respond to Carl's question, at least one part of it. That is this concern about freedom.
Fred's going to be in Los Angeles this Friday. He's going to be talking about same things that he spoke now, and also about other things. He's going to be this Friday. We have your father here. It's a public meeting, open 21. It's going to be talking about the capitalist economic crisis, racism, budget cuts, and permanent war. Things that are very important to our living. This Friday, 7 p.m. Mm-hmm. And also, as you mentioned, he's a member of the Workers' War Party. And for those who want to see, we have the latest edition of the Workers' War Party newspaper at 321, wants to take a look. And also helping us organize.
Do you have copies of those here?
Yes.
Freedom. Freedom. Who's got freedom? We don't have freedom to have a job. We don't have freedom to have a good education. We don't have freedom to have good health care. We don't have freedom to have a pension and to retire in comfort. We don't have freedom to have our children grow up secure. What freedom do you want? I mean, freedom of what? You got to be concrete. Freedom to exploit? That you got. Freedom to be exploited? You got that. Freedom to be beat up by the police if you're black or Latin or Asian or Native? You got plenty of that freedom. You got all kinds of freedom. But it's not the freedom we need. It's their freedom over us. We need our own freedom for ourselves. That's the kind of freedom we need.
I'm kind of going back to what he was saying in the middle right here. I think it's more about like the fact that people living out of necessity. That's what's going to keep people in check as far as not letting the production grow too much and keep it into the check we need it to be. Because when people have too much more than they need, that's what causes the overinflation.
Decide what's necessary, though.
Well, what you need to live.
Well, I personally need very little. I could live without this shirt. I have one underneath. I mean, who's going to decide that? It's too personal.
That's the point. You got to make sacrifices as a person to sacrifice for the better of society. That's what it comes down to. You can't be so... like, oh, I need this because I want it. It's about what
that sweater,
someone,
you need that hat.
Somebody else.
No.
You might not need it, though. That's the thing.
Somebody else needs it.
I don't think racism, I mean, that's, you know, people, police beating people because of their race is not something that's legal in this country. And it could occur in a socialist country, too. And, you know, countries like Sweden and stuff really have, like, a lot of white people. So that might not happen there as much because there's quite a bit of white people. But, I don't see how does socialism promote equality in the races, because I don't think it does.
Let's go back to where does inequality come from.
Equality
is the absence of inequality. So the first thing is to analyze where does inequality come from. Inequality comes from the fact that the ruling class, the powers that lorded over everybody in society and over all the workers, are a tiny, tiny group. They live with a workforce that's about 155 million people, plus all their families. Probably comes to over 200 million people. Now, if you're a rich billionaire, and you are in a group, and you're exploiting 200 million people, You need a strategy. Because you're always on thin ice. You're always on thin ice. So what's the first thing you think of? How can we divide these people up and keep them from fighting us? How can we get them to fight each other instead? That's what the prison wardens do. That's how they keep control of prisons. They get the white racist gangs and they let them survive and they push them against black and Latin. They let the Latin gangs survive. They let they keep the prisoners fighting with each other so that they don't rise up and kick the guards' ass and kick the wardens' ass. You got to take it this way, we're all in this capitalist system. Every one of us has to sell our labor every single day in order to survive to them. It's a damn hard thing to do. It's a damn hard way to live. And it's getting harder and harder. How do they keep us from thinking about that and saying, why the hell are you doing this to me? So they point at the immigrant workers, they point white workers at black people, they talk about crime, this and that, and they put us against one another. That's where racism begins. Once you abolish the profit system and the need to divide the population and keep everybody at everybody else's throat, if you eliminate that, that's how socialism eliminates racism. In addition to that, in the beginning you carry out a very, very vigorous education campaign because people are still going to have attitudes. People don't suddenly, you know, become angels overnight. But it's part of the socialist obligation, especially in the early stages of the transition from capitalism to socialism, is to educate them. Use all the stuff that they spend on advertising to buy Stripe toothpaste or this beer or that whatever, that car, or you know, this and that. Take all of that and use it to educate people about racism, about the history of the native people, about women's oppression, about lesbian, gay, bi, and trans oppression, about all the oppressions and how they came about, and to try to transform people's attitudes so you start off right. But once there's no need to divide people, that's easy. You just do it. I mean, it's not easy to change everybody. But that's step number one. Step number one. The Cubans had a big problem. They had to combat racism on the island. That was, like I said, it was so severe that the president of the country couldn't even go to the white beaches. But they had to deal with that. They had to form a Cuban Women's Federation to deal with sexism in the island. And they struggle with it. And we will struggle with it in the United States, in the socialist United States. But that's the beginning. At least we struggle against it. The capitalists propagate it. The historical experience is that it comes to common struggle. That's the historical experience. It doesn't, and that's what a natural disaster does. It momentarily gives people an opportunity, like an opening, to struggle against something together. A flood, a blackout, a disaster of some kind. It momentarily gives them that opportunity, and it's that process of struggle. But if you get into a big social struggle that's protracted, that's when people's consciousness changes on a
going back to globalization.
Yeah. Well,
how we as a country as a whole come from being a country that produces into a major country that only consumes? Mm-hmm. How are we able to minimize, in your opinion, how are we able to minimize the outsource of work and keeping our production, whatever we produce, and consuming only whatever that we do produce, keeping our economy, our currency inside our country instead of outsourcing outside the country?
Well, that's a complicated question, but how to approach that? See, I don't think it's a question of keeping things inside the country or outside the country. I think it's a question of trying to have equitable relations with workers all over the world. There's no such thing almost as something that's made in the United States production. Or in any country. No finished product that has any number of components can be said to be the product of that country. One of the things that Marxism tries to unearth is the fact that what capitalism does as it grows from feudalism and becomes a world system is that it socializes the productive process. The productive process today of anything, any significant commodity, is the social product of millions of workers all over the world, and it's impossible to even separate out the labor. It's half jokingly, asked me where my book was made, and I half jokingly said back to you, well, if you want to talk about that, you have to go and say, well, where were the trees cut down? Where was the sawmill that sawed up those trees? Where was the pulp mill that stamped this into paper and cut it into size? Where was the plants grown that this dye came from? Or if they're chemical dyes, where were the chemicals extracted from? Where was the dyes that made the print that created this typeface? And so on. You can go on endlessly. This is a product of world labor. Of a socialized labor process that's global. And that's just the way, that's where what capitalism has brought about. It's a great, wonderful thing. It's one of the great contributions of capitalism. Capitalism has created a world socialized productive process that has the capability of bringing humanity to new levels of development that we can't even dream of yet. That is an accomplishment of private property. That's the role, the progressive role that capitalism has played in history. The other progressive role it has played has to be create a worldwide working class that has the capability to take all this over and take it away from them and use it for human good. Those are the two great accomplishments of capitalism. So when you talk about our production here and that production over there, our goal is to break all the barriers down. If we can have a socialist revolution here, the first thing we should try to do is to break all the barriers down. We can begin by paying reparations to all the colonialized people, starting with the native people of the United States, the Chicano people who we stole Mexico, the U.S. ruling class stole Mexico, half of Mexico from, black people who were brought from Africa. I mean, we can start by equalizing things globally. We want to fight for higher standard of living of workers in Indonesia. We don't want to stop. They need jobs too. They need to live too. We want to try to find ways to raise the whole globe's standard of living and bring everybody into a kind of a socialist federation. And if you have a socialist revolution in the United States, that's a good start, let me tell you. Hang on, a lot of people
are... I'm just curious, as far as the socialist revolution in the United States, I know the military played a big role in Egypt. Do you think the military itself is a fragment in the United States, or would it...
Excellent question. See? The military is a reflection of class society. The officer corps is wedded to the capitalist system. The soldiers are workers in uniform. That's what it is. A lot of them are in uniform because they got a green card to go into the military. They got promised education to go into the military. They got a signing bonus to go into the military. Well, they can't get a job and they go into the military. It's called the economic draft. They don't have a draft. It's a volunteer army. But there's also a strong economic side to it. That military will fragment. It will fragment. But it's got to be helped. During the Vietnam War, which was a draft army, our organization, Workers' Work, helped, was instrumental in creating an organization called the American Servicemen's Union. Today we wouldn't put it that way, it would be the American Servicepersons Union. That was old days before we were country. But it had rebellions in the military, in stockades, on the front lines. It had a newspaper called The Bond, which was on 100 bases and ships, and was circulated hand to hand throughout the military. And it demanded, it had demands, it had to be court-martialed by a jury of your peers, no officers in the military, no racism in the military. The right to resist an imperialist war was part of, we had 10 demands. And it spread throughout the military. And a number of rebellions took place. In Fort Dix Stockade, there was a rebellion. There was a rebellion in Stockade in Vietnam, I forgot the name of the Stockade. So what I'm saying is this. One of the parts of making a revolution in any place is to get the workers in uniform on the side. That's how the Russian Revolution happened.
So you don't think that they fought on American citizens that were revolting?
They might in the beginning.
They might.
But if we're organized, we will be able to swing them. We will be able to swing them. Now, the Egyptian people are now learning a lesson. In the first stages of the rebellion, when they got Mubarak out, they were chanting, "The army and the people are one." That was a mistake. It wasn't the army and the people who were one, because the military brass in Egypt are a complete corrupt layer who are tied to the U.S. and who get $1.5 billion in aid from the U.S. military every year. But it was false consciousness, as the woman back there so aptly said. But now, that same military that let Mubarak go is putting demonstrators in jail. So now they're going to have to learn to change the slogan to "The soldiers and the people are one." I wrote an article on this, hoping somebody in Egypt would read, explaining to them why that slogan once had some validity when Colonel Nasser overthrew the feudal monarchy, and you know, it may have had some validity in history, but now it has no validity. The soldiers and the people are one. We tried to win the military during the Vietnam War, against the war, to undermine the war against the Vietnamese people. It was a war of oppression. It was a war of colonialism. They put Agent Orange and have ruined generations in that country. They destroyed much of the country and destroyed a lot of human life and human morale and so on. It was a barbaric war. And we wanted to break it up. We wanted them to get the officers. And by the way, one of the things that forced Nixon and them to Vietnamize the war, to take the U.S. troops out, was that the troops were beginning to kill their officers. There's a term called fragging. If you ever hear this word, fragging, you know what fragging means? It means tossing a grenade into your officer's tent. That's what it means. And that's what's going right at the end of the Vietnam War when they pulled the soldiers out. It was like a spontaneous rebellion from underneath. And it had a lot of and as a result of us forming the American Servicemen's Union, the Pentagon passed a rule saying no unions are allowed in the army. But it'll come back, especially if they have to invoke the draft, if they get into a big war, and they have to invoke the draft, things will change. Because workers today, they've had it. These soldiers over there, they get wounded, they go to the VA, they just lie in the VA. They're just all shot up. The Republicans now are trying to reduce their benefits. Military families are up against it. It has the makings of pulling the army apart. Not right away. It's the last thing to happen because defying military discipline is extremely dangerous.
And we have time for one more question.
Yes.
Passionate,
Okay.
All right. Well, it's the last question. Okay. It's kind of a comment question because she brought up a couple things that concern me a lot. The woman who was sitting there, she said, "How do we change how people think, and how do we get them to be less individual and more communal?" That scares me personally because I love my individuality and I love my independence. But she also talked about shifting into a communal attitude. I like that I am separate. I like that I'm independent. Mostly from my government. I need help on some things because I'm a poor college student. But, you know, everybody here is, I think. So, and also, you talked about the damage that war does to our soldiers and how they're sitting here in the VA. But then, right before that, you talked about creating a schism in the army and getting and all this uprising and rebellion. This will inevitably cause violence. And I can't condone that, especially within our own country. It's bad enough we have crap going on everywhere else in the world. I don't think I could condone that right here when we're fighting each other. If your ideas, I know they're in the right place. You're striving for something very good, and I respect that, but I don't think it'll work, and it'll only work if you convince everybody else that this is the right way, and everybody follows through 100%. I don't think that's possible. That's my piece.
Well, yeah, that's a comment. And you raised like four or five
important
questions. No, that's okay. Feel free. I mean, that's what we're here for, to talk about this stuff. And I appreciate the fact that you bring these things up because they have to be dealt with and they have to be discussed. And we should all feel, you know, fine about discussing them. Some of them is so big, I don't know if we have time to answer them. I want to just say two quick things. One, I don't think there's a conflict between individuality and communal social, socially conscious attitudes. In fact, I believe that your individuality has much more range in an environment where people feel socially connected to one another. I think you get much more benefit from everybody else's feedback, I think that the range of opportunities available to you to create, to be creative, will increase. One of the things about capitalism is this. It makes people one-sided. Because of the division of labor that it creates in society. First, the division between those who work with their minds and those who work with their bodies. That's one big division. But then within that, people who work with their mind are pigeonholed and channeled into one thing and become specialized and must do that all their lives. Or hopefully, if they get laid off and their thing goes out of business, they'll find some other niche in life. And the same thing with workers. They get channeled. You're a carpenter for life. That's it. Nowadays, you can't be anything for life. You're lucky if you keep any occupation for 7 years. But whatever it is, you're channeled into it. Under socialism and communism, where there's an abundance to keep everybody free, and you stop thinking about your labor time, and you stop thinking about what you've got along the lines that man has told you about. You will be free to be as creative as you can be. A poet, you can do whatever, and next year or next, you can do something completely different that you suddenly discovered about yourself. That's impossible under capitalism. That you cannot take advantage of all this wealth and so on to just relax and be creative and go from what you want to something else. Under socialism, where there's enough to go around for everybody, and you work because you work. You work because that you're socially conscious. It becomes part of your life. You do what you contribute to society. You're not, it's, you know what alienation is? A term in Marxism called alienation. Your life's work belongs to somebody else. What you do for 8 hours a day, you're on someone else's time. You're not on your own time. It belongs to them. You're alienated from that. But if for that 8 hours you're doing something that you feel is contributing to your community, to society, to the world, you're not alienated. You feel good about it. You don't stop feeling good when you punch the clock in. And you know, and then, oh man, 5 o'clock. My life begins again. It doesn't have to be that way. What you do with your life can be part of the growth of society. It comes back to you, it comes back to your neighbors, it comes back to your relatives, to your community. In Cuba, when they needed to build housing, the whole community would get together and they would build the housing. And then everybody would decide who gets the housing because they weren't able to build enough for everybody. And they would inevitably pick the people with the largest families, who needed it the most. When they built those houses, they didn't feel like, oh shit, when is this going to be over? They did it with enthusiasm because they were doing it for the community. And that's the way life should be, all the time, for everybody. And that's what a socialist society would bring about.